The Lord be with you. I am Pastor Sandra Carlson Alexis, and I'm here at First English Lutheran Church in the sanctuary. This is our online worship only, which we're going to be airing at 10 o'clock on Sunday. This is our chance for the summer, the third Sunday of the month, to include different voices, different instruments, different music. So we hope it's a nice variety for the summer on the third Sunday of the month. Today is the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. It is Father's Day, and today we recognize graduates, so there's a lot to celebrate. We gather together knowing that the Spirit has called us to be a people. No matter where we are together through the Spirit. And now our confession and assurance. Holy God, we gather together delighted to be your children. We are your sons and daughters, loved and welcomed in your family. Relationships are meant to support and challenge us, but we do not always value them. We come to you today admitting our human faults and ask forgiveness. Redirect us in our relationships with you, with our family, and with our extended community. Knit us into a trusting, caring people united in love. Open our hearts to see our place with others. For all the times we let down you, others, or ourselves, forgive us. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always and also with you. And you can share that peace with somebody in your household, or you can, if you're on Facebook, you can put it in the chat, or just today, just make a mental image of sending some kind of a greeting to somebody. Our gathering song is Morning Has Broken, which will be sung by our cantors Melanie Diaz Dodson and Donna Tatro. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. And now we offer a special prayer for fathers, which will be read by Lara Alexis.
Heavenly Father, on this Father's Day we pray for fathers who laugh and play with their children, for new fathers coming to terms with the joys and demands of fatherhood, for those fathers who are tired, stressed, ill, or depressed, for those who struggle to balance the demands of work and children, for those who struggle with difficult decisions about whether or not to have another child, for those who are unable to feed their children due to poverty, for those whose children have physical, mental, or emotional disabilities, for those who raise children on their own, for those who have lost a child, for those who care about the children of others, for those whose children have left home, for those whose children have rejected their love, and for those who desire to be a father has not been fulfilled. Bless all fathers, that their love may be deep and tender, and that they may lead their children to know and do what is good, living not for themselves, but for God and for others. Amen.
And now we pray the prayer of the day together. Holy God, we are impatient and impulsive. Help us to stop. Help us to wait on you. Open our ears and give us new ways to praise you, and open our eyes to see your works all around us. Amen. And now our psalm litany, which we will read responsively. Our lives are filled with great joys. Our lives are also filled with great sorrows. We walk in confidence. We also stumble with uncertainty. Praise to you, O God, for the psalms that remind us of stability. Praise to you, O God, for the psalms that acknowledge our struggles. Praise to you, O God, for the psalms that offer new hope. Praise to you for seeing us through the ups and downs of life. And now one of our graduates, Julianna Smith, is going to be reading Psalm 40, verses 1 through 10.
Today's lesson is from Psalm 40, verses 1 through 10. The fourth of our six-week exploration of the Psalms offers a psalm of reorientation where God offers something new and hopeful for those who are overwhelmed with sadness. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear, and put their trust in the Lord. Happy are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after false gods. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us. None can compare with you. Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be counted. Sacrifice and offering you do not desire, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, here I am. In the scroll of the book it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. See, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord. I have not hidden your saving help within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from the great congregation.
Can you hear that? That's the singing of the cicadas in my backyard. I had to come out here and record this message with the cicadas singing because the lesson is all about singing to the Lord a new song. And that's what these guys are doing. And I have to say, I was a little surprised when I was doing some research to find out that the rock singer Bono from the group U2 loves the Psalms. And I knew Bono was a Christian, but I didn't realize he was a true student of the Bible. He especially loves the Message version because it's written kind of in an earthy, easy to understand way. And Bono said he really loves the Psalms because they have this rawness and brutal honesty. And the Psalm writers share both explosive joy that he's feeling and deep sorrow and confusion. And that sounds like what we've been hearing as we've been looking at some of the Psalms these last few Sundays. We have Psalms of orientation, and that's kind of like the joy that Bono was describing. And we have Psalms of disorientation, kind of a sorrow or lament or worry that things aren't going right. And then we have reorientation, a Psalm of regained hope. And the Psalm for today, the Psalm of singing a new song, is a Psalm of reorientation. Bono liked this Psalm, Psalm 40, so much, he wrote a song for his band called 40. The name of the song is 40. And for many years, when U2 would be ending their concerts, they would sing this song based on ancient words of Holy Scripture. The words of the song 40 are like this. I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined and heard my cry. He brought me up out of the pit, out of the mire and clay. I will sing a new song. I mean, really, how can you help but sing when you've been given another chance? And how can you help but sing when God pulls you up and redeems you? Psalm 40 is a message about being patient and singing a new song and having cicadas flying around you and knowing that you're not hidden anymore and you're not concealed anymore and you're proud of who God is in your life. So especially this year, as we have heard singing of a new song to many of us, the song of the cicada, I wanted to remind you that they are and can be the embodiment of patience and of that renewed joy. They have truly been drawn out of the miry bog of the ground and have had a song put in their mouths. And so recently at our Delaware, Maryland Synod, just a few weeks ago, I presented a message about some different things that cicadas can teach us. And I think it goes along with this whole thought of being renewed and restored, but also putting our minds into a way of understanding God's word all around us and how you can find powerful messages in unexpected places, like cicadas. So here it is. Here is my presentation for our Synod Assembly. Blessings. Hello, I am Pastor Sandra Carlson Alexis from First English Lutheran Church in Baltimore City. I serve on the Connectedness team of our Delaware, Maryland Synod, and today I'm going to share the faith practice of observation. When we think of faith practices, we usually think of reading the Bible and praying or working for justice, and those are all great. But there are so many ways to enrich your faith and your awareness of God. So, observation, what is that? It's an intentional time to stop and look around and appreciate ways that God communicates with us here and now. You don't even need any special tools to do this. You just need to look around. Every single experience you have, every encounter, could be a chance to reflect on your faith. But you have to slow down and take the time to note your observations and identify how that may feed your faith walk. Now, since I'm with the Connectedness team, I especially want you to look for connections with people. Our Synod is blessed with so many ministries and programs that can lift up and support each other. Ministries like Creation Care, Campus Ministry, Marlou Ridge, African Descent, LYO, Community of St. Dismas, Synodical Women's Organization, DART, and World Hunger, just to name a few. Each focuses on a part of our Christian ministry and reaches out to connect that ministry with others. So we can look for connections not only within our Synod, but in our world. Start by stopping and reflecting on what you can learn from something going on in your life or community. So I thought I'd give you an example. This is something that our sister congregations in Delaware and Maryland are experiencing right now. Cicadas. So I'm going to call this the Gospel According to Cicadas. Okay, don't laugh. Really, we're surprised lots of times in the Bible. Weren't we surprised to learn about God revealing the kingdom from the little bitty mustard seed when we perhaps expected the mighty cedar tree to reveal that? And of course, we sometimes forget how surprising it would be that it was a Samaritan who could teach us how to love our neighbor when we might have expected to learn from that priest or Levite. So today, yes, it's a surprising thing, but we are looking at the 17-year visitors, the brood 10, the X cicadas. No, I am not an expert on insects, but I can observe and I can do a little bit of research to see what these little guys have to share about God and faith. So, what can we learn on our faith journey? What can these little bugs teach us? Now, the very first thing I noticed about cicadas is that before we saw any of them, we found these little holes in the ground. Cicadas come from the earth, and so do we. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, it says, "The Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being." What a powerful way to remind ourselves of our connection with the earth. Do the words, "You are dust, and to dust you shall return," sound familiar? Cicadas can remind us not only of that connection we have to the earth, but perhaps you feel like you've been living underground for 17 years. The pandemic hasn't been that long, but it has separated and sequestered us. And seeing these insects come out sort of mirrors our own emerging from seclusion as more people are vaccinated. Did you notice that once they emerge, the cicadas tend to gather with other cicadas? God calls us to be community, and we're eager to be with others a little more, knowing we've all experienced a time of seclusion. And yet another just thought about these holes in the ground is how much it could remind us of the resurrection. You know, empty holes, empty tombs. There's something to reflect about there. So my next observation about cicadas is the shells they leave behind. They shed their first exoskeleton that protected them while they were growing in the ground. I'm sure you've seen these shells that they leave behind. There's actually several on the tree behind me, as well as a few ones with wings. But thinking of these shells leads me to several thoughts. How many of us are living in shells that need to be shed? How many of us are wearing invisible armor because we've been hurt and we want to push people away before they hurt us? Are we wearing a shell that needs to be shed to open us to more intimate, healthy relationships? Do we need to shed the shell of prejudice based on the color of someone's skin, their ability, their sexual orientation, their political party? Or do we hide in our shells, like keeping our gifts and talents under a bushel basket, when we could let our light shine before others so that they may see our good works and give glory to our Father in heaven? See, those cicadas, they're teaching us quite a few things, right? So let's look deeper at what these little buggers can teach us. Number three, look beyond the surface. So here's a close-up of a cicada. No, cicadas are not the prettiest of insects, right? They're not like the beautiful butterfly with the wings of all the colors, right? But they are gentle and they don't sting or bite. In fact, they can barely fly. Admittedly, those little red eyes are jarring, but they're not bad insects. Now, what does this have to do with our life, with our call? How many times have we judged based on what someone looked like? Can little David actually fight Goliath? Nah, he'll never survive. That centurion with the sick servant, I bet he doesn't have enough faith in Jesus. And what good is a widow like Ruth? Cicadas teach us to look beyond the surface. Can that teenager be a worship leader? How can we welcome people with disabilities more? In what other ways have our eyes limited God's vision? Number four, an appreciation of time. These cicadas appear every 17 years, so it makes us think back to where we were in 2004, or where we might be in 2038. And even though some of us maybe weren't around in 2004, and maybe some of us won't be around in 2038, we still appreciate and remember that our God was and is to come. We worship the God of generations. Now, along those lines, really, the cicadas can teach us a lot about patience. By the time those insects emerge from the ground, they are already 17 years old. They have been feasting on tree sap and preparing for this brief shining Camelot moment. That takes patience. Each year on the Sunday closest to Epiphany, we at First English pass out stars with one of the fruits of the Spirit listed in Galatians chapter 5. And this year, 2021, the star I got listed patience. Now, I think I need patience all the time, but especially during this lingering pandemic when we thought 2021, it's over. I could definitely use some patience. Observing and reflecting on cicadas can bring us to wonder, how are we at waiting? Psalm 27, verse 13 reminds us, "Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. wait for the Lord. Number 6. Life is short. After waiting 17 years to emerge, the life of the cicada above ground is only a few weeks. And in that time, they need to crawl out of the ground, shed their exoskeleton, grow wings, mate, lay eggs, and die. Carpe diem, right? The book of Ecclesiastes encourages us to enjoy what we have today. Jesus told his followers, God provides for the birds of the air so that you can live each day knowing God cares for you. There's no need to worry about tomorrow. Appreciate what you have today. Those are just a few thoughts about lessons we can learn from the gospel of the cicadas. Just from a small example, like cicadas, we can reflect and think about life lessons that God might be teaching us about how we have this connection to the earth, how we can think about shedding some shells in our lives, how we can be reminded to look beyond the surface and appreciate time. We can also be reminded of the great gifts of patience. And never bad to remember that life is short. Those are just a few thoughts about lessons we can learn from the gospel of the cicadas. This is just an example of something you can do to enrich your faith life. So in your quiet time, just stop and look. Stop and think. Stop and reflect about what God is showing you in the course of your life. How can you learn about God through different things that are going on? Like, let's say you're feeding your dog or changing your cat's litter pan. Could that be a chance to contemplate God's care for you and your call to care for God's creation? If you're planning your grocery list or maybe an upcoming vacation, could you pause to think about how God plans for the church's future and cares about every day of your life? If you're driving through traffic during rush hour, what if you thought the best of the other drivers, knowing our call to love our neighbors? And if you need to stop what you're doing on a busy day to take care of a child or maybe nurse a baby, could this be an opportunity to set aside your probably way too long to-do list and just slow down and be still? So many things can be reflected upon, and there are riches to be found when you stop and use this discipline of observation, whether you're gardening or dealing with a coworker or maybe just online noticing a trend. Stop, look, reflect. What is God telling you through this observation, and how does it link you to God's plan and to your neighbor? Blessings to you. Let us confess together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now for our prayers of intercession, just a reminder, every time I say, Lord, in your mercy, your response is, hear our prayer. Both in person and online, we come before the triune God in prayer. Holy God, you gather your people from east and west, north and south. We pray for the mission of the church throughout the world, that your steadfast love may be made known to all peoples. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You laid the foundations of the earth, and the waters are the womb of creation. The morning stars sing your name, and all creation shouts for joy. We pray for your blessed creation, that it may continue to flourish and magnify your glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You keep watch over all nations. We pray for all countries experiencing violence, hunger, and unrest, especially Myanmar, Belarus, Ethiopia, the Church in the Holy Land, and the Palestinian-Israeli conflict. Be with victims of gun violence, especially in San Jose. Guide worldwide and local community organizations in their efforts to establish safety and justice. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You are close to the brokenhearted and near to those in distress. We pray for those who are experiencing oppression. Liberate us from the systems and chains that bind us. Remove the barriers that separate us from one another. We think of this especially during June, Pride Month. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. You dwell with us in this faith community. We pray for our worship leaders and council members. Grant them knowledge, patience, and kindness, that through their leadership you may be exalted in this assembly. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of Shalom, we pray for those responding to this pandemic in hospitals and vaccine sites. Be with those who suffer with COVID and those who have lost loved ones to the virus. Be with those suffering in India and Brazil and other places around the world with outbreaks. Help us to care for each other in our cautious reopening. Watch over those who stand up for equality and justice issues made clearer through this pandemic. Fill us anew with your Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of peace, we pray for the city of Baltimore and our online mission field, for our leaders, Joe, Larry, and Brandon, and our bishops, Elizabeth and Bill, for those who seek healing through the 12-step programs usually offered in our coffee house, for our prayer partner, First Lutheran Church in Ewan, Michigan. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Your love endures in all situations. We thank you for those who have cared for us. Be with those who are in need of healing, including those in our prayer list, Jack, Kathy, Frankie, Judy, Helen, the Stahl family, Andy, Carol, Dolores, David, Bill and Dee, Chris, Doris, Richard, Barbara, and Barbara. And among our friends, we pray for Keith, Susan, Bill, Helen, Ron, Laura, William, Cisco, Donna, the Thomas family, Mary, Marcia, David, Chantal, Cheryl, Jennifer, Adalbert, Walter, Ray, Norma, Brad, Frank, Danielle, Jay and family, Paul and Sarah, Gary, Elijah, and Joan. We also pray for those who are grieving, for the friends and family of Alice Christensen, and the friends and family of Michelle Smith, Tim Smith's sister-in-law. Bless those who grieve. Use all of us to care for each other in the holy family of the faithful. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. And for the offering, we have a little bit of information that will be listed here. You could text an offering, you can mail in an offering, or you could go to our website and click on the button that says give, and that's another way to support our ministry. And again, we're so grateful for the generosity of our members and our friends. And now our offering prayer. Jesus, bread of life, you set your table with your very self and called us to the Feast of Plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us. Make us to be what we have received from you. Make us your body for the life of the world. Amen. And now we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, since we are not taking communion in person right now, here's a prayer for spiritual communion. Most holy God, during these times when we worship online, let us be the living body and blood of Christ. Bless us through the Holy Spirit to accept and offer forgiveness to our communities so that we can share the good news of your love. We ask this in the name of Jesus through the Spirit dwelling among us now and forever. Amen. And now some of our notes for mission. We have, first of all, the Claim Walkathon, which has already taken place, but we are encouraging people to continue to do a virtual walk if they like, or just make a donation if you would like, and there's going to be information at the end of this video about how to donate for the Claim Walkathon through the Delaware, Maryland Synod website. It's not too hard to do. Also, we are going to be having a memorial service for Alice Christensen this Friday, June 25th, in the sanctuary here at 7:30 p.m. Your attendance and or your prayers are certainly welcome and encouraged. In addition, we have an outdoor vacation Bible school that is coming up. It's July 26th through the 30th, and it is for young ones. The youngest are about 3 or 4 years old, and we go through fifth grade, I believe it is. And that is going to be July 26th through the 30th, 6 to 8 p.m. in the evening. It's just cooler. It's going to be an outside VBS. It's gorgeous. I was just out there where we are going to be having our vacation Bible school, so I'm really excited about that. And now the blessing. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever. Amen. Our sending song is They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love, which is sung by our First English Ensemble.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, we will walk with each other, we will walk hand in hand, and together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. Christians by our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other, we will work side by side, we will work with each other, we will work side by side, and we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father from whom all good things come, and all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son, and all praise to the Spirit who makes us one, and they'll know we are Christians by
body of Christ. Thanks be to God. Blessings.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be saved.